Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to engage in conversations about important issues. Welcome to our video voters guide. And welcome to Shanti Lewallen, candidate for U.S. Senate. Hi, nice to have you here.
Thank you, Marge. It's nice to be here.
Great. Well, could you tell us a little bit about why you're running for this office and why you chose the Senate?
Well, I'm running primarily to keep the Working Families Party on the ballot. The Working Families Party helps voters distinguish between candidates that are friendly to labor and income inequalities and concerns in the workplace. They have to run a candidate every few years.
Okay.
And get a certain percentage of the vote. I think it's 1%. But as I've gotten into the campaign more, I've found a surprising amount of support for a third party candidate who is concerned about these issues, a lot of which were brought up by Bernie Sanders in the primary, and are looking for someone to vote for besides the Democrat and Republican candidates that have been put forward.
Now, I know that there's a lot of issues out there that are really important. So let's start with trade. Tell us a little bit about your thoughts on the TPP.
Well, right now we have two senators that disagree on the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is essentially viewed as NAFTA on steroids. Mm-hmm. It has all of the protections for foreign investors against regulations that we have that protect workers, the environment, really consumers, everybody from unfair practices that threaten our safety and income security and this kind of thing. Merkley has come out against it, but mm-hmm. Wyden actually sponsored the fast track to make sure it went through Congress without the kind of review that we expect for most legislation.
Okay. So would you feel that, I'm going to switch to money and politics mm-hmm. because that seems to be the driving force behind a lot of these issues. Tell us your thoughts about how campaign finance reform, what kind of priority is that for you?
Well, I think that across the political spectrum, we recognize that this is a time when corporations and moneyed interests have much more power than individual citizens. And that is not the way that our Constitution was written, and that's not what we fought to maintain all these years since the founding of this country. And so I think that there's really widespread support across the political spectrum from ordinary citizens for some reforms that really empower representatives of the voices of people in their constituencies rather than the representatives of corporations far and wide who support their platforms. And I think Ron Wyden is a perfect example of someone who takes a lot of money from corporate backers. The biggest industry that supports him is securities and bankers.
Mm-hmm.
Health insurance companies are also among the top. Oil and gas companies. My campaign is financed by ordinary Oregonians, small scale contributions. I'm not beholden to those money interests, and so I can promote. Policies like single payer medical, coverage.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I can propose policies that reform our elections financing system so that people like me have a voice in the future and are not drowned out by big money.
Okay, you mentioned healthcare and the Affordable Care Act. There's been some concerns since some insurance companies have dropped out of the system about its sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
So would you want to fix the Affordable Care Act, or would you want to start over?
Well, I'm in favor of whatever gets the best care to people as possible. I think that we need to take a step back, and maybe the majority of members of Congress disagree with the Hippocratic Oath. But I think that we need to enable doctors to provide the care that they took the oath to provide, which is the best care that they can and the best prevention that they can. And I think that this system that's so strongly influenced by by profit, and the profit motive really diminishes what should be our focus on healthcare and so many other social services, from education to criminal justice reform to funding for the schools. We need to decide where is the profit motive appropriate, mm-hmm. and where is our other motivating factors, such as outcomes and providing really a lot of service for the money we put in, things that we should be prioritizing more.
Okay. There was a recent decision to remove private industry from the criminal justice system at the federal level. And so what are your thoughts about how we can improve on criminal justice issues? Right now we have, it seems to be one of the most hot button issues.
Well, yes. Is that the end of your question?
I don't want to interrupt. Go ahead.
I think that the strength of our country is the diversity.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of times when we have a social problem like those surrounding the criminal justice infrastructure, it's very hard to get Americans to come together and commit resources. And so we take these kind of like really reactive, drastic approaches. Mm-hmm. So you get things like the war on drugs and the war on poverty and the war on crime, when really I think the focus should be, instead of on criminalizing addiction and criminalizing, you know, a lot of the indicia of poverty, we should be focusing instead on how do we address those issues in a way that has a long-term sustainable kind of approach to moving away from these punitive measures. And absolutely, I think that just like with healthcare and schools and mental health, we mm-hmm. need to take the profit motive out. And I think that a big part of that is trying to get some buy-in from the people that are in that system now, whether it's the administration or the workers or everybody. Let's try to get people retrained and repurposed toward a more rehabilitative, reintegratory, if that's a word. We need to reintegrate people into society who've been marginalized by this system that really just kind of shuts people out, slams the door on them.
Okay. You mentioned profit motive, and right now there's been some movement toward making a profit off our public lands. And through mining, there's gold mining, there's logging, whatever, even in our national parks. And I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
I think the idea of logging in our national parks, in our wilderness areas, in our, you know, wild and scenic rivers is insane. I think that we need to look back at the vision of a prominent, you know, Republican, mm-hmm. Teddy Roosevelt, who set these lands aside to avoid these exact kind of, you know, wild boom bust sort of, you know, winner take all approaches that we're seeing, you know, promoted by folks that want to privatize the forests and privatize the public lands. What I'd like to see instead of this is you know, more local input that looks into sustainable management of these resources, so that we have, you know, good tall stands of trees for generations, and so people can really tie in and take ownership of that stewardship and really view it as, you know, kind of a regional source for products that are going to be put into mills throughout Oregon. One of the first unions actually to endorse me was the Pulp and Paper Workers Union.
Right.
And they've just been slammed by these free trade agreements that have shipped, you know, working, functional, profitable mills overseas, and just completely ripped off these workers and left these communities with just rural pockets of poverty. And I actually grew up in the woods and watched the fishing stocks. I was born in 1980. Mm-hmm. I watched the fishing stocks collapse and the timber stocks get liquidated, and people were left without a job. And, you know, it's hard to have a family wage when all you have is tourism.
So in maybe one sentence,
yes.
Could you tell voters why they should vote for you as opposed to your opponents?
Well, I think people should vote for me so that, well, really to send a message to the Democratic Party that we need to have more voices from everyday Oregonians, from workers to environmentalists to people that are concerned about consumer rights on really critical issues like trade and healthcare, and we need to, you know, take the big money out of politics and really focus on what's important to our constituency.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being here, and I thank you for taking this on.
Thank you, March.
Thank you.